afternoon and welcome to tonight's Sunset Safari. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Wim the Wildebeest Dornbank on camera. We have Jamie and Jandre out on the other vehicle. And we have Geraldine and Louise in final control. And we're sitting on our southern boundary. We've had a look for Karula's tracks. Alas, she stays to the south. And we're going to head east towards Cheetah Plains. And hopefully, this very warm winter's afternoon, it's about 24 degrees Celsius, 70 something Fahrenheit, quite windy, gusty, very dry, lots of dust in the air, you can smell the dust, and let's hope it brings us some animal luck. We've been struggling for leopards for the last little while, but hopefully that's going to change. And remember, if you have any questions, African bush, pop me an email on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. And anything I can't answer, I'll be sure to hand over to Jamie for her to deal with. So, here we go. So that Inkahuma lioness who's got her cubs not too far from where we're sitting right now in Torchwood, in this little drainage system there. Nice rocky area, really well protected. Not too many hyenas in this part of the world, so that could be one of the reasons she's chosen to den here. But fingers crossed we'll be able to see those little bundles of joy in the near future. Hello, Ashley in England. Ashley said she hasn't been on for a while. Please, could she have some updates? Cubs, movements of lions, everything. Well, we'll give you a quick one. Well, Karula's still got two cubs. At the moment, they are in the property to the south of us. Shadow has lost one cub, but still has one. Nkanyin has two cubs on Cheetah Plains. And I think that's the leopard cub update. Lions, sticks have eight cubs. They're on the Mowati River near the Malamala boundary. Nkahumas have two cubs, and I think the other female is going to drop within the next 3 to 4 weeks. So there should be a few more Nkahuma cubs. Lions, Nkahumas are in and around Buffleshook, Juma, and Torchwood. Birmingham's as being Birmingham's are scattered all about, wandering vast distance. The Matumbas made a brief appearance at Sibambili before scurrying back down to the south. And that's about it. No! Male leopards. Tingana is still the dominant male through most of our traverse area, although Gajima from the north is spending more time on the Buffleshook cut line. We are really hoping to see Shivambalan, who's one of Karula's offspring and who's the dominant male, down on Cheetah Plains. Quarantine's also hanging about that area. No word on Kanuma for a while. Anything else you can think of, Vim? No. Ah, and Tandi is around here somewhere. I think she was seen this morning in Chitwa heading north towards the Mulwanini River, which we're about to cross now. So while we continue to Cheetah Plains, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
Attack! We lost Brent at the same time. I was really viciously and savagely attacked by a buffalo thought. That was a surprising start to our afternoon. Hello everybody and welcome to our sunset safari. Now I'm all disrupted and my blankets that I use as a booster seat to be high enough to talk to you have all become dislodged. There we go, okay. Returning to normalcy slightly. The buffalo thorn hooked on the light on the side of my vehicle and I was faced with the prospect of a face full of very sharp thorns. Hello, my name is Jamie. I have Jandre on camera with me once again. And you find us on Hyena Road, double checking to see if there's any sign of that mystery male Gijima. And leopard that hangs out in this particular region and has been looking to annex it as part of his territory. This morning we were plagued by gremlins, but we're keeping our fingers crossed that the tech team has managed to work their magic. It is very much a work in progress, however, and Wendy's had a couple of hard, difficult moments over the last few days. But hopefully we're about to turn a corner, quite literally and figuratively, and we'll start off with our first sighting this afternoon, apart from the bumps, of an elephant herd. Elephant herd that is really quite tricky to see. I think I might have to go forward a little bit for you, Jean-André. There you go.
So unfortunately, Wendy continues to have a few gremlins, but new parts are on their way from the big city about 500 kilometers to the north, Johannesburg. So hopefully that should arrive soon, and that should help get Wendy back to being splendid. Now, you caught me while I was trying to eat my nachi. I'm not sure what most of you call a nachi. It's one of those weird South African names for a fruit. I'm actually not sure. Vim, do you know another name for a nachi? No. Maybe someone else out there can tell me what nachis are called in the rest of the world. But it's like a cross between an orange and a lemon, but smaller and sweeter. So not, what was the orange? Oh, I can't remember now.
It's also easier to use.
It's also easier to peel. Very tasty. Vim, would you like some? There you go. Mmm. Very tasty, very sweet, very juicy. The perfect late afternoon snack while in the African bush. We're nearly at Cheetah Plains now. So we got Torchwood to our north and Chitwa Chitwa to our south. Now this is Tundi's area around here. Nature is a beautiful, says the only leopard I missed is in Vula, and she hopes he's okay. Not such the best news. I've recently seen the latest data, and Vula has been pushed well south. He's literally scampering between different male territories, so I'm not sure how he's doing, but unfortunately with male leopards of that age, that they do have a very torrid time trying to avoid all other male leopards and lions and all sorts of other creatures. So hopefully he hangs on for a bit longer, but he definitely is at the end of his sort of, or he's beyond the end of his reign. He's now definitely just in survival mode. Well, thank you to Emily and Anne. Emily says in the UK we call them, well, now I've forgotten now, but they're not nectarines or tangerines. We know what those are, but apparently answers they're called clementines in the UK. I've never heard that before, but I'll take your word for it, Anne. So there you go, Nachi is a clementine. We're now on what is called the Cheetah Plains driveway. And there's a little link road that runs between Nkoro and Chitwa Chitwa that takes us onto the plains of the cheetah. And quite often quarantine can also be found in this area, so fingers crossed that either quarantine or Shivambalan or Nkanyini are around on Cheetah Plains at this sunset safari. And we'll just throw in a cheetah or two for good measure, hopefully. So we are coming up to a little dip at the entrance of Cheetah Plain that does sometimes give us a little signal breakup. So we do apologize beforehand if you do lose us for a second or two. Okay, so we're going down into the dip. Hopefully all's well and you're with us, but we do have a little bit of a problem here, but we'll scoot through it as fast as possible. So what we
All right, let us see what we can find on the crest of this hill so that Brent can get through the bad signal dips and I don't risk finding any of my own. Unfortunately, I'm not even entirely sure if you did manage to see the elephant that I tried to show you earlier, but if you didn't, well, I'll describe it to you. It's a very large grey thing that was flapping its ears and hiding behind a very green tree, and as we turned the camera upon it, we disappeared from your screens apparently. I'm looking for more large grey things, but hopefully further up the top of the hill so that we have better signal. It is interesting, however, just how many elephants we've seen over the last few days. There's just been an influx of elephant herds 30, 40 members strong, and yet we spoke to some of the guides working at Simbombeli and around Arethusa. They've hardly seen any. It's interesting how that rotation is working, because we do go through periods where we've got lots and lots of elephants, and then all of a sudden they disappear for about a week or so. And we don't see them again for a while. Oh dear, we come to another dip. I think about racing through here. I'm trapped. I'm trapped between two bad signal patches on the crest of a hill. I know that my signal's going to disappear if I drive any further forward, so I'm going to send you back to Brent.
So we are maneuvering through the northern sector of Cheetah Plains. Vio and I have just been discussing what we would like to see today. And we would love to see cheetah in full flight across those open areas. So, fingers crossed. Oh, quite a lot of elephant activity here. Always good on a nice warm afternoon like this, have a look at the water holes. So we might do a swing past the Cheetah Plains pan, see if there are any ellies there. Always on the lookout for whatever else might be out here, and maybe I'll find a new nearly impossible tree on the plains of the cheetah. So far, just a lot of elephant tracks. So Jason in Manchester is wondering, is there any evidence that animals will track like we do by looking at paw prints? No, nothing. Jason, no. They'll track by scent, by hearing, and by sight. And actually, when I say sight, physically seeing the movement. The way most predators' eyes are designed, they see in sort of various shades of gray and black and white. So they will not, they don't see definition like we do. And that is why quite often, if an animal keeps really still, a lion might walk straight past it. So they really need that movement, and the tracks don't not moving, it's very difficult, or actually virtually impossible for those animals to actually see a paw print in the sand. But they'll be able to smell it, and that's their advantage, and it's probably far more effective than our tracking of tracks by sight. Quite a gusty day, a windy day, could make some of the prey species feel a little bit vulnerable, especially if this wind carries on into the evening. I highly doubt it though. These winter evenings are beautifully still. From about 5 o'clock-ish, that wind just dies down completely. This is that area that quarantine's been hanging around in, Shivamba lions have been seen in Kanyini, and the two cubs have been seen in. So, got our eyes up and open. I know Herbert's out on foot, unfortunately. He did call me on the Game Drive Channel 1. I'm now too far to reach him on a handheld. So I think Jamie will try to call him. I think he's got some leopard tracks somewhere on Game Drive Channel 1. And I think she's going to get hold of him now. But I'm a bit too far to talk to him on a handheld. So hopefully Herbert's on Karula tracks, or it could be Tingana tracks. Somewhere on Juma, he's been out since early trying to find us a leopard. So, a dwarf in Pittsburgh is wondering if there have been any sightings of Shivinzi, or Shivindi, Shivambalan's sister. Not that I've heard of. I don't think she's around anymore, and if she is, nowhere near us. But I might be wrong. I'm sure one of our regular leopard experts can't wait to tell me where she is. But I think I haven't heard of her since I have been in this part of the Sabi Sands. Oh, Nancy would like to know whether we'll be seeing any giraffe today. Well, Nancy, you never know. Just maybe. We saw some on the sunrise safari, so we have seen some today. On the sunset safari, we'll have to wait and see. Always pays to check carefully in these little glades. Oh, and the flies are really bad. Coming out onto the first of the open clearings, there's some impala in the distance. Nice big group of impala, or two, or one herd, but spread out quite nicely. Amazing. We haven't had flies for a few days, but they're out in force today. There we go. Grazing on the short grass plains. We can hear that strong wind. Good for the predators. Oh, them on the ground, on the little road here, right next to us. You got them there, just to the left of the bush. So that way. Oh, yeah, you can see it running across the road there. Here we go. Now there's one for the birders, a difficult one. Let's see if you guys can identify this bird. And if you know what bird this is, send the answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Look at the leg color. Look at this eye stripe. Nice design. Nice figure.
That is on the big, on the right.
Just there. Nice markings that help with the diagnostics of the bird. There's a pair of them running around, and that's the one closest. Male and female are conspific. They look the same. Okay, well, off that little birdie goes, and we shall do the same. Oh, terrible flies. Try to go a bit faster, get rid of them. So while we see what else is out on the open plains, let's go to Jamie, who's with some striped donkeys.
A striped donkey, or a donkey in pyjamas. This morning we had a herd of well over 30 zebra. Now most of them are currently occupied up towards the Juma Dam, as I think some of you will know from watching the Juma Dam camera. They're taking advantage of the shade there. A mixed breeding herd, but sort of lurking at the back with somewhat hopeful expressions is a group of three bachelor stallions. In a group together, keeping each other company and honing their fighting skills in preparation for the day, and they will be ready to compete for mates of their own. This gentleman on the right is absolutely enormous. He is well on his way to being ready to compete. Excuse me. is a very stocky, very large zebra. You can see the difference in terms of size between him and the other two. They're enjoying a little bit of shade on this very warm afternoon. Despite the fact we're still in midwinter, the sun is exceptionally strong. On first glance, it is very tricky to tell the difference between a male and a female zebra. In this case, well, the best way is probably to have a look at the stripe between the cheeks of the bottom. A very thin stripe will indicate a female, whilst a larger stripe will indicate a male. And then, of course, there's the fact that each zebra has a completely unique set of stripe patterns. And just have a look at the stripes on this gentleman's back leg. See there where they've all sort of broken lined, like they've been interrupted. That could well be from an injury months ago that healed up, and you often see zebra with slightly mismatched stripes become quite skew. He's resting very comfortably on his right or his left hock, making sure that he has taken some weight off his back leg. That's an old injury. It's amazing just how resilient zebra can actually be. And the same applies to all of the animal species out here. As soon as they get a little bit of an injury, they heal up exceptionally quickly. I've just heard exciting reports that Herbert has found, and it is Herbert, that is how he says his name, despite the slight miscommunication that has occurred within camp in terms of how to pronounce it. Herbert left earlier this afternoon whilst we were getting ready for drive, and he's found some leopard tracks for us to help him follow up on. We're slowly making our way back towards there, and fingers crossed, it is our beloved Queen of Juma, since it is in the right, exactly the right area for her. And hopefully we shall have some signal there as well, which we should. It's a good spot. Bye-bye, zebra. Good luck in your future endeavours. These three boys will have to compete for access to females through fighting with other males. It's a very zebra-themed morning because there's even more of them hiding off in the shade here with the group of impala, or the herd of impala, to be more correct in terms of using the English language. Here we go. Sorry, excuse me. Oh, thank you. Breathed in some dust somewhere along the line. And you can see just how well hidden they are. Not far away from us at all, but the stripes working their magic and associating with a herd of impala. Many eyes, of course, the more eyes the better. Protection of the herd structure. Oh, got a little impala who looks like she's got a bit of a limp. It's not too bad. She doesn't look too seriously injured. Now, very good afternoon to Monique in London. You were wondering, we're going to stop at our zebra gentleman again, since we've got a slightly different view. Hello, boys. You were wondering about just how water-dependent a zebra is, since there was a large group of them around the dam. And the answer is actually really quite water-dependent. They usually drink at least once a day. With their digestive systems being the hind gut fermenters that they are, they need to consume a lot of food, about twice that of a ruminant of an equivalent weight, so an antelope with four stomachs. But they also therefore produce a lot of roughage and require a lot of water in the digestion of their food. So whilst they can be dwellers of arid regions, for the most part they are more commonly found in bushveld areas like the one in which we find ourselves, where they have regular access to water. there's a good chance that these zebra are going to start making their way towards the pan. Meantime, let's find out what Brent has found on Cheetah Plains.
So, Gnomeless, Gnomon the Gnu, for those who are not aware of who this is, it's the dominant male wildebeest on the southern sector of Cheetah Plains, and he's got himself a nice little harem of females at the moment, but this windy weather has got them all sleeping out in the open on the clearings and ruminating. And watch, there we go, you can see the side to side movement of a ruminant's jaw as they chew the cud. So they'll bring undigested grass up from their stomach and chew it again and again to get the maximum amount of nutrients. And unfortunately, that's about all we can see. There's some zebra in the distance, some more wildebeest in the distance, but no sign of the cheetah at the moment. But don't worry, we haven't stopped or given up hope. It could still be anywhere around here. And cheetah being crepuscular animals, definitely one of my favorite words, crepuscular, which means most active at dusk and dawn, are likely to get moving a little later as the sun dips a little bit lower and a little bit closer to the western horizon. So Lael's wondering, besides trying to outrun the cheetah, does ostrich have any other defenses? They do. Those long legs of theirs deliver one almighty kick, and also very sharp claws on there that can do some damage. So they will try kick away predators as well, only if they can't outrun them. If they get into a position where they have to fight, they can inflict some serious damage with those long legs. Kitty, kitty, bang, bang, is wondering if I've ever encountered ostrich on foot, and have I ever been chased? I have. We had one particularly grumpy ostrich on our family farm who put everyone in a tree at some point. He used to attack you while you were fishing. I've even jumped into the dam to get away from him. But they tend to become very aggressive and very curious, the males especially, during the breeding season. The females, I've not really ever been attacked or chased. They normally move away from you. So never by a female, but by a male, yes, I have been chased on multiple occasions, both on foot and on vehicle. So we've got a few answers in for the bird quiz. Sanderling, Buffy, Pippet, and Pippet. Oh no, not yet, guys. Come on, you're gonna have to work a bit harder. What are you doing? Kruger boundary, Ben? Kruger boundary. Let's see what's been coming in from the national park. So the fence that used to run here between the Sabi Sands and the Kruger was only dropped in the early 90s, 1992, if my memory serves me correct. So we're looking for any form of tracks. The last wild dogs tracks I had were on the Kruger boundary, but unfortunately going into Kruger. We've seen some nice big herds of buffalo in this area, some big Ellie bulls, but yet I think to find a predator on the boundary itself. Here we have tracks of a nice big herd of elephants heading into Cheetah Plains. So hopefully they'll move towards the pan a little later. Andy's wondering how come there's so many large mammals in the area that seems to have such limited resources, water and vegetation. Well, Andy, I wouldn't call it limited resources, and we are in a drought, so it might seem a little bit more limited than normal, but this is the type of areas a lot of the animals prefer. The low veld of South Africa, sweet grass veld, intermittent with acacias and mixed broad-leafed woodland. Is sort of very much ideal territory for a lot of the large mammals and provides normally enough food. And you must also remember drought is what we're not normal, what we're going through at the moment. It's a bit old, and there are male leopard tracks here. Very, very old. You can see it is quite windy, but I think they're even older than that. They've been driven over. See them marching off there. Nice big male leopard, possibly Shivambalan, or who knows, maybe a new leopard from Kruger. Off they go into Kruger. Oh, and back again. But not fresh enough for us to get too excited about finding. So Andy, as I was saying, that this area is perfectly designed to be able to take those large mammals. You see them there, VM. Now, not such a large mammal. A little female steenbok. Incredible little antelope. Now, that's an adult, not a baby. And one of our few antelopes that is completely not dependent on water out here. They get enough moisture from dew in the morning, and they also dig up little tubers to get water. Of course, if there is water available, they will drink, but no, not necessarily dependent on it. They can live in some of the driest areas of Africa. A monogamous antelope, so they stay together for life. And you can see little steenbok, he's disappearing into the mixed broad-leafed combretum woodland. And while that steenbok disappears, and we continue to head north down the Kruger boundary, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
Well, Brent explores as far east as he could possibly go without trespassing into the Kruger National Park. We've come pretty much almost as far south as we can go, and I've been in contact with Herbert on the Game Drive channel, and he tells me with a tone of great excitement that the tracks that he saw were very, very fresh. What I'm doing in order to help Herbert is to basically cut ahead from where he has his tracks. I've cut towards the direction they were going in just to see if she hasn't popped out somewhere on this road. We're keeping our eyes peeled on a hot afternoon like today. She might have a kill. He didn't mention anything about cub tracks, but you never know. She might be taking her cubs back towards this area. I was reading some interesting statistics about the sort of the percentage of time in a very highly monitored female leopard, this percentage of time she spent with her cubs at different ages. And initially, those first 2 months or so, when the cub is denning, the female actually spends more time away from them than she does with them by about, so it's a sort of a 60-40 split, 60% of her time away and 40% with the cubs nursing and caring for them. And that slowly, that balance slowly shifts as they grow a little bit older until it becomes sort of towards 50% and then towards shifting in the opposite direction. So more time spent with the cubs than away. Now that makes complete and utter sense if you think about the fact that the cubs are weaned at around 3 months of age. They might still be suckling a little bit, but for the most part they are almost fully able to survive, not without their mother, but to survive without their mother's milk. Now at that point she can start taking them with her to the kills that she's caught. Whereas when they're much younger, they're not capable of climbing trees, they're not ready to be able to deal with the risks that come from being associated with a carcass out here. The biggest risk, of course, being hyenas or lions or even other male leopards. And without the proper coordination or ability to climb trees, it's just safer for her to keep them hidden. And now we're right at the stage with Karula, since her cubs are now close to 4 months old, that they are starting to spend more time with her. Now, Karula's made some interesting choices in her time with these little cubs in terms of where she has decided to den them. Dr. Debbie, you were wondering about what sort of choices an animal will make, a predator will make, in terms of picking a den site, access to food, availability, water, and so on. And it depends very much on the animal concerned. Most important for, at least with the leopards and the lions, the most important factor that they will have to consider is where is the safest place in terms of males moving around that area. So Karula will want to stay sort of in the heart of her territory, so keep them away from other females, but most importantly, in an area where she knows that she's mated with the leopards, or the male leopards of that area, and that they are dominant and in control. Because any kind of newcomer that... Oh, there's a golden-breasted bunting. Jandre, it's where the dead are. Oh, come back. Come back. Where did you go? He's... Not the one I was going for. Different bird. There's a hoopoo. We've actually come into a bird feeding party accidentally. I was looking for the golden-breasted bunting that I saw earlier, which is related to the cinnamon-breasted bunting, also known as the cinnamon bun bird. Where is it gone? No. It was a nice thought, but it has definitely disappeared. And these getting the little birds on screen can sometimes be exceptionally tricky. We've got a little weaver there. It looked like a red-headed weaver, but without its breeding plumage. The red-headed weavers only have those bright red heads around the summertime when the weather is fine, and it's their breeding season. Let's just double check around the southern boundary just in case she's come back to fetch her cubs for some reason. Well, we've got Herbert walking in this block. Oh, sorry, Dr. Debbie. Back to answering your question. That will be probably one of the biggest factors they will consider. So it's less about resources, especially for leopards and even for lions and for wild dogs. They can travel quite far afield to get food and to get water and then return to the cubs. As long as those cubs are safely stashed away and kept away from other risk factors. Now, with Karula, for example, we think that she shifted her den site to the south in order to keep them away from potential increased hyena activity close to her normal preferred den sites. Now, was there a reason why Karula decided to, and Shadow did the same thing? Both Karula and her daughter Shadow both chose culverts in the road, drain pipes going underneath a main access road in which to keep their cubs at the when they were very, very young. And we all sort of shrugged our shoulders in bewilderment as to why that seemed like an appropriate choice. There's constant traffic, but there must have been something in the back of their minds. Now, wild dogs, it's a little bit different in terms of where they choose. They keep the pups well within a very limited area for the first few months of their lives, and they can do that because they're not single parents. So we've got the entire pack that will head out hunting and can, as you know, travel enormous distances before returning and regurgitating food, both for the mother or the babysitters, and then the pups as well as they start to wean. Now again, resources, not too much of a factor initially. Now, things start to change once those cubs get a little bit older and they get ready to start eating meat and to start practicing their hunting skills. I'm not sure if James Richard is watching, but I'm trying to find him a really nice baboon track. We spoke about the difference between male and female tracks. But the sun just isn't quite right. Let's try. I put us here. Doesn't really make it terribly clear. I'm looking at these ones here, Jandre. Probably the clearest. Here we go. Just got the five fingers. Seen so many baboons. And this morning, the Nkuhumas were reported to have caught one, which is relatively unusual that they managed to catch the baboons so out of focus that they were caught napping on the ground. A lion is no match for a baboon, whilst it is when it's in a tree, but they can occasionally catch them on the ground. And James, if you are watching, this isn't terribly easy in terms of measuring size because you can't see all that clearly. Now what I'll do is I'll try and trace out the size of the track for you. We've got a hand here. This is the worst drawing stick in the world. That was useless. There we go. So we've got a finger here, four fingers and a thumb, and the back of the hand, and then the foot. Actually, this baboon was changing directions. So there's the back pad of the foot, almost the shape of a human footprint. And we've got them moving like that. So with the hand on the outside, and then in this case, the back foot falling inside of the hand. Now this would be about the size of a male baboon's tracks. So close to, their back foot is close to the size of my hand. Their front foot is a little bit smaller. If you think about it, a big male baboon's about 25 kilograms, or just over 50 pounds. Now if we go here, it's not terribly clear, I do know, which is why I'm going to trace it out for you. This is the hand of a female, an average-sized female. So there's her foot here. I know it's not all that clear, but you do just get an idea of a comparison of scale. Both of her feet much, much smaller than the size of my hand. Oh, there you go. It's not the best example, James, but we were lucky that we got any tracks on this main road. And we'll keep looking. And this is not just for James, obviously. This is for all of you that are interested in tracks and the art of tracking and what it can tell you about the animals. Karula. Now, William, you were wondering about how we know all of these different tracks. And the answer is, first of all, we've been fortunate enough, all of us, to have been taught by different and very experienced trackers. Second of all, we've had a recent brushing up on our tracking skills that came from a gentleman called Arrhenius, who was brought in to help us and to teach us a little bit more about tracking. But in general, all of us are very familiar with tracks from watching. The best way to learn a track is to see the animal, watch what it's doing, and then to see it, to go and check what tracks or what footprints it has left behind. It's the best possible way of learning. And that's wonderful. That's actually really fun, because once you've done that, when you do see tracks, you can actually build up a picture in your mind about what has happened. You can almost picture it. And you start to, what I find I start to do when I see cat tracks now, and I start to picture the speed that they're moving at, I can almost imagine them walking down the road in front of me. It's a scene that, fortunately for us, we've been treated to so many times in the past. That sight of a feline sachet down the road. And that's what I start to do now when I see certain tracks. I picture what's come before it. And of course, it's not just about the tracks. It's everything from the signs of rubbing to places where they've brushed up against grass, where they've flattened grass. And what Herbert is doing now is probably one of the hardest things to do. And that is to track a leopard, not on a road. Any of us can follow a leopard, set of leopard tracks walking down the road. But to actually follow a leopard right through the middle of the bush is a really interesting exercise, and it takes a degree of expertise. Sometimes just a little bit of luck also helps. We're going to be trying to help him out as much as we can, because I definitely have not seen those tracks coming back across and out of this block, which means she's here somewhere. She's hiding here somewhere, in the shade most likely, hopefully with a full belly, and hopefully with two little cubs in tow. So, Janet, you were wondering if you have a better chance of seeing a cat on a sunrise or a sunset safari. To be completely honest, I think probably your chances are the same for both. I think it's probably about 50% each way. And the reason I say that is the mornings is a great time for us to be out. The cats, especially on a winter morning, are still very mobile, but we haven't had the head start of a drive before that, if that makes sense. So we have to start from scratch every morning. Whereas at least in the afternoon, although the cats generally are not as mobile until it gets dark, we've had a day's worth, or at least a morning's worth, of preparation. And if we haven't found a cat in the morning, we know where the cats aren't. If that makes any sense. We know where they aren't, and so we've got a better chance of figuring out where they are. So I'd say it's an equal toss-up. They are more active first thing in the morning. Here we come past where Herbert has disappeared into the bush. He's somewhere in here following up on Karula. I've done all I can to help him for now. I've checked all around. I've made sure that the tracks don't come out the other side. So we'll expand our search slightly farther afield until he calls us back, if he calls us back. Just in case we missed them driving across, or in case somebody else drove over them. And that she has actually moved a bit further than we thought she has. It's all a delicate operation, tracking. And animal sightings entirely dependent upon the amount of work that one puts into them. We stopped earlier for... Oh, hold on a second. Change of pace, change of animal subject. Don't disappear. Let's go forward a little bit. It's a bit tricky. Wait and see maybe if they decide to come out into the open instead. To a foraging warthog. Hello. It's all right, little pig. Oh, here's that typical tail erect of a warthog that's got a little bit of a fright. And that, of course, is so that they can follow each other through long grass. Basically acts as a little antenna, especially for baby warthog that are running away with their mothers. Having that tail up in the air is a really useful way of, almost like a guide walking around a very crowded city with a big signpost or a big umbrella or something. It means that the baby warthogs can follow behind the mother safely. This one's got, the way that the light is shining on this particular warthog, she almost appears to have very red hair, almost ginger, lying across her back. And that, when a warthog is threatened, gets puffed up, just like our Nyala do, when they're trying to make themselves look big and scary, the male Nyala. Warthog are capable of doing that as well, making themselves look big and scary. Known as piloerection, and the little babies can do it as well, and the little babies have the additional factor that they've got white sort of chin straps, white fluffy tufts of fur that grow out of their chins to make it look more like they've actually got big scary tusks. Most of the babies of the season are almost at about 6 months of age. So most of them have started getting their tusks now. And we've got a little one just on the left that's busy snuffling through to get to the root systems. Backwards and forwards, dashing about, and off they go. I think that's interesting that they waited as long as they did before deciding that they weren't comfortable with that level of focus and attention on them. And generally you'll find that most animals are exceptionally comfortable when we drive past them. And it's only when you stop to look at them, when you direct your focus on them, that they will dash off and seek deeper cover in the bushes. Now, Chitra, just quickly to chat a bit about your question. You were wondering if I could discuss the hierarchy of a baboon troop. And it's something that we spoke a little bit about this morning, or we touched on a bit this morning. Now, essentially, a baboon troop is actually a fascinating little unit of up to 30, even 40, sometimes even more baboons in a group. And what it's made of is basically a couple of different, kind of like hyenas, but definitely don't confuse the two different types of groups. So we've got a couple of different family female lines. So a female, her daughters, maybe her sisters, and so on. And then a separate unrelated group of females, and then another unrelated group of females, all together in this troop, all living relatively peacefully, but that actually have dominance hierarchies within the females. So the females do have a set status. It is inherited. In other words, a young female will inherit the status that her mother has. So if she's quite a low-ranking female, then the baby will automatically be low-ranking. And all of this is overseen by a group of two, three, four, sometimes, dominant males that are relatively peaceful in their own hierarchy. So you might have one that's more dominant than the other, but in general, they're pretty much on a very even footing. They just happen to have their preferred groups of females over other groups of females. They will mate with them, they'll all have a different chance to mate with the group, and they are largely responsible for protecting and keeping that baboon troop safe. And there's a very interesting, they very often intervene, particularly with their favorite females, but they'll intervene in order to stop the bullying that often occurs from females of a higher ranking towards those of a lower ranking. So very often what will happen is when a lower ranked female has a baby, it goes through a stage where it's very small, it's black in color, and it's not strong enough yet to be sitting on the mother's back or clinging to her belly. So she's actually got to hold it with one arm and move like this. And what happens is all baboon females are exceptionally attracted to this tiny little baby. They all want to handle it and they all want to mother it. Their maternal instincts get sort of overwhelming in this case. Now, if it's a female of a higher rank, that's okay. None of the other females will mess with her. But if it's a female of a lower rank, what will actually happen is that the higher ranking females will come and bully her and try and pull the baby away. Even though the mother's protesting and the baby's protesting, the higher ranking females still want to hold it. They don't want to harm it. They want to mother it. And the screams and the squeals will immediately attract one of the big males, who will then step in to return a semblance of order to the peace of the baboon troop. And they're responsible for the discipline as well. So male baboons, what they will do is if there's a young male that's showing an undue interest in a female coming into estrus, or if they're causing trouble, or if a female is causing an unnecessary amount of squabbling, then they will step in and separate them. And that's why we very often hear, pretty much, if you've got a baboon troop around, you'll hear it at least once a day, if not more, those screaming shrieks. They squeal and scream at each other. And that's discipline being enforced by the large dominant males. Very warm welcome to the kids of Kempsville Elementary School and the class of Mrs. Jimison. Hello and welcome on safari. Now, just to explain how this all works, my name is Jamie and it's my job to drive the vehicle and to chat to you and to find animals to show you, and not different types of animals, birds, reptiles, snakes, any of the different kinds of things that you can find here in the African bush. And then behind me sits a man called Gendre. And Gendre has a camera, and he's basically showing you, you're looking through the eyes of the camera. Now what you're seeing is happening in real life, right now and right here, in a game reserve called the Sabi Sands in South Africa. It's a place where we have lions and leopards and all other wonderful manner of different things. And because it's happening right now in real life, what that means is that you can send through any questions that you would like to ask. You can do that through your teachers, and then we'll be able to speak directly. It's like you're sitting on the back of the vehicle. So we can speak directly to you, and you can chat directly to us and ask us anything you'd like to know about the different animals. Mackenzie, welcome on our safari. You wanted to know what inspired me to be a safari guide. And it's an interesting question. For as long as I can remember, I've been very lucky. I was born in South Africa, grew up in a city called Johannesburg. But my parents were always really interested in taking me out to visit these wonderful natural areas. Even from one of my earliest memories was a big lion, a big male lion, walking past the car when I was about 2 years old in the Kruger National Park. My grandfather was also a game warden, so this was one of the things that he loved, and he used to sit with me in his study when I was young and read me lots of books about and tell me lots of stories about animals. And when I was about 8 years old, I went to a very special place called the Rhino Camp, and I got to spend time with a type of rhino called a black rhino, and in this case his name was Bwana, meaning brother. And I got to feed him and I got to spend a bit of time with him, and I think ever since then I've just always known that this is where I want to be and where I've wanted to work and the sort of job that I would like to do. And I'm very, very lucky in my life to be able to do something that I love, because it's not really like work. It's just my everyday life is so very exciting. And speaking of exciting, we're actually coming upon some of the most typical animals of the African bush. Brent describes them as donkeys in pajamas, but they're actually some zebra, and we're in luck because there is a tiny baby little zebra here for you to look at. Hello, zebra. Here we go. Look at that tiny little thing. Now, if you look very carefully, you can also see all of the birds that are sitting on its back. Those are oxpeckers. And what they're doing is they're picking off things like ticks and parasites that are making the little zebra very itchy. So they're actually helping the baby zebra, which is called a foal. Just like a horse, it is called a foal. But I think they're also irritating it a little bit. There's Mom on the left. She's also got the oxpeckers all over her. And this is one of the best places to find zebra, out in an open clearing. They're very fast animals and they eat lots and lots of grass. So what that means is that these big open areas where there's not too many trees but there's lots of grass for them to eat is a good place to find a zebra. A very peaceful scene. And just in case you're wondering what's at the back there, that is a lodge. That is where the guests that are coming on safari get to come and stay. Sarah, you were wondering about what kind of different habitats I have seen out here in the bush. Well, there's so many different kinds. Where we are at the moment, it's mainly what's called a savanna habitat. So it's a combination of a tree layer and a grass layer, and it's a very delicate balance. But I've been able to work in a desert before, in what's called a green desert. So it's a desert, but there's still a little bit of rain, enough that there's some grass covering the rich sandy soil. And then I've been to places where there are grasslands, and you might even see some of those with Brent. And then you get the river areas, which we are very close to here. Look at that absolutely enormous animal in the background. That is called a Cape buffalo. And I think we should try and get a little bit closer, and I'll tell you some interesting facts about a Cape buffalo. In this case, it is a male, which means that they can be not grumpy or aggressive, but they do like to have their own personal space. And they generally, in terms of where you'll find a dugger boy or a mud boy, a male buffalo, will be wallowing in a dam or in a puddle. Let's go a little bit closer, see if we can't get a better view. Noah, you were wondering about how we know where to find the animals. And the answer is a couple of different ways. Some of the animals here have territories and places where we can regularly find them. And then again, it depends on what type of habitat an animal likes to live in. So I know that these male buffalo like to spend lots and lots of time wallowing in water. They also need to drink water at least once a day, if not more than that. So I know immediately that I must check all of the watering holes if I want to see buffalo, for example. And then sometimes I follow the animal's tracks, the footprints that they leave behind. There you go. You can see all of the oxpeckers sitting on this buffalo's back. Now he is really unlucky because while an oxpecker, so the birds with the bright red beaks, they usually help to keep the ticks and the parasites away. Sometimes, like with this buffalo, when they have a cut or an injury of some kind, the oxpeckers actually peck at it. So they just keep hitting it with their beaks and they keep it from healing. So oxpecker birds can either be really, really helpful or they can be really irritating for any of the big animals. There you can see on his shoulder, he's actually got a big sore cut, and that's what that bird is pecking at. Shame, boy, that can't be very nice at all. You see him looking at us. So Noah, how would I find a buffalo? I'd go to water. How would I find a leopard? Oh, that's a different story. I would go and look where there's lots of places for a leopard to hide. If I wanted to find a giraffe, I'd go where there's lots of places with trees for them to eat, and so on and so forth. Look at this crazy antelope. He's not crazy. He's actually an impala who is doing what's known as rutting. So he is running around making a lot of noise. And there's another big male that's coming behind him, pulling funny faces. They both are. And if we're lucky, we might even hear them making that sound again. They're trying to intimidate each other. And the reason is, it's time for the impalas to mate with the females. And there's lots of competition between the males. And we might even be lucky here. We might even see them get to have a sparring or a fighting session. See how they're walking towards each other and pulling those funny faces, almost like they're yawning. He's threatening the other male by lowering his head like that. But both of them, after a couple of weeks of having done this all day, every day, I think both of them are a little bit tired. And they're both pretending to be a bit aggressive, but they might not actually follow through just because they are so exhausted from weeks and weeks of fighting with other males as well as chasing the females. I can't even see any of the females at the moment. He's saying don't come any closer, but he's not actually tackling the male. So they're threatening each other, but they haven't quite got around to actually physically fighting. And this impala is definitely winning this fight, this battle of wills, because he keeps advancing forward. And the other impala keeps moving away. Oh. Paige, you were wondering about why it is a zebra's mane sticks up so much. And the answer is because having a long flowing mane like a horse in this kind of area with so many different thorn trees would actually be really tricky because the mane would just keep getting stuck and caught. Sorry, can I just show you what this silly buffalo is doing? Sorry, Paige, I will get back to you in a moment. But just look what this buffalo's done and where he's decided to go. I'm hiding in a tree. He's found the least comfortable looking spot. But I think it's because he's itchy. He wants to scratch his back and get rid of the ox pickers. And there's the injury that was on his shoulder that the ox pickers were pecking at. I think that's why he's hiding. He's actually trying to escape those birds. Okay. So, away from the silly buffalo and back to Paige's question about the zebra. So, zebra are very similar to horses. And let's show you a zebra while I answer your question. But they live in a place where there's lots of trees and there's lots of thorns, and they need to be able to escape very quickly if a lion comes hunting. Now, what that means for them is that having a long mane would get in the way and would get caught on the various sticks and branches and thorns that are out here. So if you cut a horse's mane really short, you'd also find that it would stick up like that. Now, the only time that a zebra will ever, the mane of a zebra will ever flop down is if they are very, very hungry. Oh, Parla running across. So yes, it's only if a zebra is quite sick that their manes will drop over. What's interesting about zebra is that is the only way that you can tell that a zebra isn't feeling well. And that's because they have these really, really round bellies. And that, oh, bless you, Gendre. Gendre having a quick sneeze. Zebra are what's called hind gut fermenters. So all of the grass that they eat is digested and absorbed and broken down in their intestine rather than mostly in their stomachs. And what that in turn means, because it's all done by little, tiny, microscopic animals called bacteria, what that does is it actually produces lots and lots of gas. And yep, that means that zebra fart a lot. Sometimes they even scare themselves with their own farts. That's because of the way that they digest their food. You can see, instead of having a short tail though, they have long furry tails that swish around and get rid of any of the flies that are buzzing about them. Now, Kailani, you were wondering if we have any animals here that you might not see in your zoos. Oh, I'm not entirely sure. I mean, most every animal that you see here occurs here naturally. This is where they've been born. This is where they've been for the last couple of tens of thousands of years. I'm not sure exactly which animals you have on your side, but most of the animals here, I think, are completely unique. And we're so lucky because what you're seeing is totally wild animals. They've been born and they look after themselves in a wild area that is the size of 4 million football fields. Our buffalo bulls have escaped and disappeared, but there is somebody else who would like to say good afternoon and to show you more buffalo, and that is Brent. So why don't you jump onto the back of his vehicle?
So one from one group of buffaloes to another, and another little bachelor group, and you can see all the birds on them eating the ectoparasites or ticks and mites. I mean, see these little black and white birds in front of them as well. Well, let's look at the birds. There we go. Red-billed oxpeckers. Beautiful little birds. And then we've got those little black and white birds in front of them. The blacksmith lapwing. Maybe catching any grasshoppers that the buffalo disturb. We're out on Cheetah Plains. Welcome to Kempsville Elementary. Wonderful to have you on safari with us. My name's Brent, and VM is my cameraman. And ask us as many questions as you want about the African bush, and we'll see if we can oblige by answering. So we've actually been looking for a male leopard most of the afternoon. We found his footprints going into this area behind us. But while we've been looking for him, we noticed all the buffalo. So we decided to come have a quick look at the buffalo, also giving us a chance to listen. And if you listen, you can often find animals by hearing. So that's what we're doing, hoping to hear where that male leopard is. Well, let's carry on, see what else we can find. And there we go, nice little group of buffalo bulls. Like the other ones, also hanging out around a bit of water. There we go, there's a little water hole here. And those old buffalo bulls really like to hang around the water. They've got food close by, they've got water close by. They're not trying to compete with the younger males that are in the breeding herds at the moment. So they just have a sort of relatively a life of leisure around the waterholes, of course, till the lions arrive, because one of our lions' favorite foods is the buffalo. So not only are there male leopard tracks around here, but there's tracks of two male cheetah. So we're going to go across to the next open area, and maybe we might find a cheetah there. So while we do that, let's jump on with Jamie.
Now, here's a different type of antelope that you may never have seen before. And this is called a nyala. N-Y-A-L-A. A nyala. And this is a male nyala. And there's actually two male nyala. Now, we saw the impala pulling faces and chasing each other earlier. Now, the nyala have a different technique when it comes to trying to fight for female attention. What the male nyala do is they actually dance with each other, or sometimes they even hit the trees with their horns to show how big and scary they are. And that's what this boy is doing now. Oh, except that he just got a fright from a bird. Yes, That's very intimidating, buddy. Yes, now he's going to scrape the trees. And have a quick grooming session. Now, nyala are one of my favorite antelope, just because I think that they are so incredibly beautiful with their fluffy coats, the fluffy ridge of white, and then their big thick beard that runs all the way down their necks. But Wade, you were wondering about what my favorite animal is to find. Oh, that's such a difficult question, Wade. I think one of my favorite animals to spend time with is an elephant. I just think that our African elephants are some of the most incredible animals in the world. They're so, so clever. And hopefully while you're still with us, we'll be able to find you some elephants to show you. I also really enjoy spending time with spotted hyena. A spotted hyena, like the ones in The Lion King, are actually amazing animals. He's trying to get rid of that bird. He's finally managed. Just look at how beautiful he is in the afternoon light. Walking behind the zebra. We don't often get to see nyala out and about in these open spaces, just because they like to hide away and spend time hidden in the vegetation. Jaden, you were wondering, are there any animals, or do lots of animals camouflage themselves out here? And the answer is yes, lots and lots of them do. The zebra have the stripes as a way of camouflaging themselves. The nyala are sort of very cleverly striped with white stripes running down their sides, which makes them, when they're walking behind trees with leaves, it kind of breaks up their outline and hides them away. And then, of course, the best camouflage of any of the mammals is a leopard or a cheetah. Those animals, because they've got those spots and because they're the sort of the color of dried grass, can disappear even when you're only a couple of meters away from them. But also bear in mind that mammals are not the only animals that count. There are certain bird species that are also perfectly camouflaged. And I've been trying to look for some now. Of course, it's tricky because they're nice and hidden. But I've been trying to look for a type of bird called a Franklin. And a Franklin, I promise you, is the perfect color of dry grass. You would, if it sits still, you would never know that it's there. And they're actually quite mean like that, because what they do is they hide in the grass, sitting really, really still. And then we go out for a walk to see if we can't find an animal. And they'll wait until you basically nearly right next to them. Then they fly up out of the grass all of a sudden and give you a really big fright. But that's a different type of camouflaged animal. And before we go, since we have got such a lovely scene here, Tanya, you were wondering about what part of South Africa we live in. We live close to the top northeastern corner. Bearing in mind, South Africa is a very, very big country. Not quite as big as the United States, of course. The United States is absolutely massive. But we're in the top northeast corner of South Africa. And in particular, we're in a game reserve called the Sabi Sands, which is named after the Sabi River. And the Sabi Sands is all part of the Greater Kruger National Park Reserve. And I'm sure that your teacher will help you with a map to show you exactly where we are after you've been on safari with us. And there's just so many different types of animals for you to see. And Brent has found another one of the different antelope species.
So we're out on the southern section of the plains at Cheetah Plains. And there we got some wildebeest out on the short grass and some zebra. And you can see this is a favorite spot for the cheetah as well. This nice big open grassland. Short grasses, not a lot of bushes in the way, so a cheetah can get up to their optimum high speed of 70 miles an hour. It's the fastest land mammal on Earth. So sometimes it always pays to sit quietly and watch on these open plains for a little bit, because the cheetah will sometimes sleep on the edge and be watching the wildebeest and zebra, looking for a baby or a weak one that they can possibly hunt. Now, it's not uncommon to find wildebeest and zebra in the same area. Now, a zebra is a bulk grazer. So it just eats everything. Where there's a wildebeest is a very specialist grazer and will only eat short grasses. Now, while we sit here and peruse the open plains, Ian is wondering, what is the weirdest animal I've ever seen? Well, Ian, that's an excellent question. I've seen quite a lot of weird animals in my years out in the bush, but I say probably the weirdest looking animal we get right here in the Sabi Sands is an animal called the aardvark, or translated, that means earth pig. And I'm going to find a picture of one for you right now, so we'll show you what an aardvark looks like. So it's a very interesting mammal. It's quite a big mammal. It can weigh up to about 180 pounds, and it only eats termites. And there we go. That is what an aardvark or earth pig looks like. It's a very strange looking creature. And it's got a very, very long tongue that it gets in there and licks up all the termites. It's got incredibly long and powerful front claws, and it can dig deep holes. So if something just scared the zebra, I think they might have smelt something. It suddenly just jumped. And I think maybe they're just being a little bit nervous. So we're going to leave the zebra and we're going to move a little bit further to the west to where the cheetah tracks might come out. While we do that, we've got a question from Abigail. Good day to you, Abigail. Abigail would like to know, what is our climate like? Well, we're in winter, Abigail, and we complain that it's quite cold at the moment, but it's not really compared to what you guys are used to. It's a very temperate climate, very hot in the summer months. So in summer, during the day, we sit anywhere from 85 to 105 normally during the heat of the day. In winter, we're probably sitting mid-70s to high 70s during winter. And the coldest we ever get around here is about 30. That's very unusual, maybe happens once or twice a year. So a very, very nice warm climate. So we're quite low. So we're only about 400 meters above sea level. So that also helps with that. Noah is asking a question, a very good question, Noah, and it's something I've wondered and pondered for many years. Noah would like to know, how many stripes are there on a zebra? Well, each individual zebra, Noah, sorry, is that a cheetah track I just saw, is different. It is not. We'll carry on. So every single animal, a zebra, is different, Noah. So not one zebra has the same set of stripes or the same number of stripes. So it's near impossible to tell. But it is a beautiful, beautiful late winter's evening. So Preston's wondering, how do we tell the difference between a male and female cheetah? Well, Preston, the males are bigger, quite a bit taller, so therefore when we're looking for footprints, we can tell that it's a male footprint because it's bigger than the female footprint. And even young males, very quickly, at less than a year old, their feet are already bigger than their mom's footprints. So that's how you know it's a male, from the footprints. But when you see them, the males are a lot taller and a lot bigger. So just over this hill is apparently where the tracks were heading towards. Hello, Kira. And Kira would like to know, how do giraffes defend themselves from predators? Well, Kira, number one, they're very tall and they got very good eyesight. So their first form of defense is to spot a predator before it gets to them. Number two, those long legs are very big, very heavy, and the giraffe can kick very well with them and kick in all directions. And many a lion has actually ended up dying when tangling with a giraffe, and they've managed to break the lion's jaw with one of those powerful kicks. So I'm hoping we're going to find not only the cheetah tracks, but preferably the cheetah. Hi, Candy. Candy would like to know, do birds, the oxpeckers, take ticks off the baby animals as well as the adult animals? They do, definitely. The babies are a bit harder for the oxpeckers because they tend to move around a bit more, but they definitely do take ticks off babies and adults. Hi, Ryan. Ryan would like to know, how long have I been a safari guide? Well, Ryan, a very long time. I've been guiding since I was 18. And I'm now 32, nearly 33. So, my maths is not good. That's why I'm a safari guide, Ryan. But so what's that? 10, 12, 14, 14, 15, nearly 15 years. But before that, I actually lived in the bush, so I grew up in the bush before I was old enough to be a safari guide. I used to sometimes work as a tracker for my dad, and as well as anything in the bush. But I lived in safari lodges growing up, so I've been very lucky. And there was always only one place I was going to end up, and that's in the bush looking for all the animals. And I thought I saw a track there. Now, how we find all these wonderful animals, specifically the big cats, is through lots of different ways. One of the most important ways is finding their footprints. So if we find their footprints, we can see which direction they're going in. And some... No. Oh, Vim's seen a track. And that's what's so great about our cameraman. So I watch this side and Vim watches that side and he's seen a track. What have we got here? Let's see if we can show you this track. Oh, beautiful track. Not a cheetah track, it doesn't look like. It looks like a leopard track. So I'm going to show you how we can tell. Can we get the track from here, Vim? Okay, so Vim spotted. Always make sure there's not a leopard behind you when you're looking at the tracks. Just a squirrel. So Vim spotted a leopard track here, and from its size, it's a female leopard track. It's a little bit old. It's not that fresh. You can see the edges are a bit hard. So if it'd been a cheetah track, so all the cats always have these three little bumps at the back. Hyena will have two like that. But if this had been a cheetah track, cheetah are the only cats that can't pull their claws in. So you would see little claw marks in the hard sand. Here's a stick, that's probably a bit better. So you would see often like that, pretty much like that. You just see the two front claws. Can you see that, Vim? But so this is the leopard track. There's the back of the leopard track. And then there's one toe, two, three, four toes. But it's not a very fresh track. It's quite hard. We've had some misty mornings. I guess it's probably from maybe yesterday or the day before. So a nice fresh track would be much, much easier to see and be really, really clear. So that's one of the ways we find animals, is to follow their footprints. So that track's not very fresh, so we're not going to follow it. Now, if we found a fresh track, then you'll see me get much more excited than I normally am, and I'm quite an excitable guy, especially when I'm out looking for animals in the bush. Good spot, Vim. And the other way, and quite often, the most important way we find animals is using our ears. So lots of different animals make different noises. And a lot of animals, especially animals like we've been seeing so far, impala and zebra and wildebeest, if they see a lion or a leopard, they want to tell everyone that they've got to be careful, that there's a potentially dangerous predator around. So they snort. So an impala will go, pff, pff, pff. And if you understand impala, what the impala is saying is, leopard, 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 or lion. And so different animals, when they start making different noises, often lets us know if there's a big cat in the area. So where the cheetah tracks were coming from was just over there, and there's a little beautiful open area up coming up that I'm hoping that the cheetah might be sleeping in. So while we look for the cheetah, let's go see what Jamie's got.
Well, whilst it's nice to look at some of the bigger animals and to look for the different things that are living in the bush, sometimes it's a really good idea to stop and just take in your surroundings and find evidence of basically history of this area and what happened here at some point in the last few months. Now we're sitting in one of the most beautiful spots, looking across at the stunning view of all of the trees. Now I'm going to jump out and I'm going to show you what you were looking at there, because I think it might be a bit confusing and difficult for you to see exactly what that was. So over here, nice to get out and stretch one's legs. Always important to check around us, make sure that there aren't any animals hiding away behind the bushes. But here is what we were looking at, or what we started by looking at, and this is actually a piece of bone. Now very, very important that you don't touch any bones unless an adult says that it's okay. But this is part of, believe it or not, this is part of a skull, and probably the skull of that an animal like that Nyala that we saw earlier. Now in America you have deer. Deer have antlers instead of horns, and antlers are actually made from hardened blood vessels, which means that once a year they can drop off and then grow again the next year. Now, our antelope are very, very different. So this is actually the horn of the antelope, and this horn is made of solid bone. Now something has come through, something killed the Nyala. It could have been a leopard, a cheetah, a lion, anything like that. But there's an animal that comes behind and has very, very strong teeth and has actually eaten most of the skull. So all of the front of the skull is missing, and there's, if you look really carefully, you can see where the teeth of this particular animal have scraped away at the bone. And that was most likely, remember we spoke about one of my favorite animals to find, most likely that was a hyena that was gnawing on this bone. They've got incredibly powerful back teeth that, and very, very powerful jaws. So a hyena could easily bite through a piece of bone in just one bite, just closing its mouth, very strong muscles. So they're capable of making use of things that lions and leopards can't chew through. So this is what's left of a Nyala. Nice to stop and just have a look at the different things that we can find. But I'm going to return it to the earth, because there are also lots of different things out here that will be able to make use of it and to help break it down. So I don't want to deprive anything. There's no wastage out here in the African bush. So there's something that eats pretty much everything. So even though it's very sad when an animal gets killed and is hunted, at the same time, it doesn't get wasted in any way. And even a skull portion like that could actually serve as a really useful home. Let's say if a chameleon, how many of you have heard about chameleons? Well, we get them here. And if a chameleon wanted a safe place to lay its eggs, to lay her eggs, and they might actually choose to pop it in there. Now, oh, here's something else to show you. I'm going to hop out one more time, but while I do, Chris, you were wondering, hello Chris, I hope you're enjoying our safari. You were wondering about what is the animal that we see the least. Well, there's some animals that I know that we get here, but that I have never seen at all. And something like a pangolin kind of looks like a scaly anteater. It is a scaly anteater. Now they are here because I've seen their footprints and other people have seen them, but I've never ever seen a pangolin before while I've been here, or since I've been working in this area. This is what I stopped to get you. This is a snail shell. The snail is no longer alive. If it were alive, this shell would be a deep brown color. But you can see that this snail has now died. Maybe it got attacked by ants, or perhaps it just didn't quite get enough to eat. But this snail is one of the examples of what might eat what's left of a carcass. So this is called an African giant land snail. It's all filled with dirt now. There's definitely no snail hiding in there. But an African giant land snail is actually a carrion eater. In other words, it's a scavenger, like a vulture or a hyena. It will go and it will find carcasses and it will feed off them. Another little treasure that we found just in the last few feet of driving. There's plenty to see out here. And again, I'm putting it back just in case there's something that wants to come and live there. Now, there's a couple of different animals that we hardly ever see. We're very lucky. We get to see lots of leopards and lions on a regular basis, and things called wild dogs, and sometimes even hyena. But there's all kinds of things that we look forward to seeing. Unfortunately, we have come to the end of Kempville's Elementary's safari. I hope you've all had a wonderful time, and that we will see you once again on the back of our safari vehicle. Have a good rest of your school day, and I hope to see you again in the future. So from myself and Brent, and both Jandre and Dave, bye-bye, and have a wonderful day. Oh, and of course, it's not poor Dave on camera this afternoon, is it? It's with Brent, it's Viam. Sorry, Viam. Oopsie. I got confused. Wonderful news from Cameron, who is 6 years old and Maddie's brother. Cameron, you want to know if there are any scorpions about. Unfortunately, Cameron, not at the moment. They're all sleeping in their holes right now underground. Because we're in winter now, they're not hibernating, but they're doing what's known as estivating. So Cameron, we're going to have to wait probably until, unless there's a bit of rain, maybe it gets nice and warm unexpectedly, we're probably going to have to wait till around August, September, before we start to see more scorpions. But they are here and they are around. And I'm very, very happy to hear that Dyson, named after, of course, the great Scott Dyson, that Dyson the iguana is doing well and is very happy. I am thrilled to hear it. Well done, Cameron. I'm sure you are taking really good care of him. And Cameron, we'll keep an eye out for scorpions for you. You just have to keep watching. And I'm sure that both Brent, myself, James and Sam will all look for scorpions. And whenever we see one, we will always, always think of Maddie. Right. Let us see if I can get hold of Herbert, see if he's had any success. Hopefully he hasn't been trying to reach me while I was wandering about off the vehicle. Herbert for Jamie. Okay. He might actually
Jamie, have... Jamie, what are you looking for?
Sorry, Quibus, just looking for Herbert.
Okay, sorry. Herbert, coming by.
How's it going, M4? What's your position?
I'm still in the block between Ibama and Tilmon cut line. The tracks are coming up and down inside the block. She might have crossed Philemon to the west.
Copy that. I'm checking along Zoe's road now. I didn't see anything on Philemon's, but there was lots of traffic up and down there, so they might have driven over it. Herbert's discovering what it's like to track our Queen of Juma, Karula the Leopard. That's affirmative. I drove Philemon's cut line. I'm checking Zoe's now, and then I'll check Rebecca's.
Okay, thanks.
When Karula is hunting, I've had at least three different experienced trackers come to me and say that Karula is one of the most difficult leopards they have ever tracked before. She has this uncanny ability, and I'm sure it's a hunting strategy that she obviously utilizes, but she has this absolutely uncanny ability to pick a direction and then you'll lose her tracks for a while, and all of a sudden you'll find her tracks again, walking at 90 degrees to where she was walking before, or sometimes even at 180 degrees. So she's turned right around and is going in completely the opposite direction. So it's a matter of, she keeps you guessing, certainly. And one day, when I come through here, one day she will be lounging in this beautiful Balanites tree, just waiting for us, with that delicate expression of insouciance that she wears so well. But not today. One day there will be a leopard in this beautiful leopard tree. And not just James trying to climb it. We're going to continue to help Herbert out, see if we can't figure out where she's gone. In the meantime, let's find out how Brent's exploration of Cheetah Plains is going.
Okay, so the male leopard we are scouring for, unfortunately no sign of the cheetah, but it is a firm favorite of a lot of our viewers out there. It's the quarantine male. I heard he crossed at the end of the sunrise safari this morning into this area here. And as you can see, it's not ideal. Very thick, but I'm hoping Mr. Q is going to be lying up in a tree where we can see him. Or he's going to be heading towards Cheetah Plains Pan for a drink as it gets a little closer to sunset.
Peter Kuman, from Wood. Goedemiddag, from Wood. Vanuit hier, Johnny, dankjewel. Je eerste naam van onze andere hier. Jij wou op.
Okay, so, and look at this gorgeous light. We now just need a leopard to fill it. So, no quarantine likes marulas. He also loves termite mounds. So we're checking every single one. So John, hi John. John is in the UK. John is wondering what is the latest on the wild dogs. So as far as I know, the Investec pack is hanging around their old den site in the Magnoletti. The Sands pack have denned on a property called Ottawa to the far west of us. And that's the update on the wild dogs so far, John. So they have not been around. We have had tracks of a pack that have come in from Kruger, which might be a pack, we don't know. But the tracks came in and out here on Cheetah Plains in the morning. So by the time we found the tracks and by the time we got to the end of the tracks, the dogs were already gone back to the KNP. Now, Jilly's posed quite the difficult question, and that is, why do birds in the warmer climates and out here seem to be more brightly coloured than ones in the cold climates? Jilly, I think with birds, I think it depends more on the individual species, and that they've developed certain colours for different reasons. A lot of birds need to attract a mate, and I think that's the main reason for gaudy colours. And birds that don't need that gaudiness to attract a mate tend to be a lot more dull. So, I'm speculating heavily here, but I couldn't give you a definitive answer on that. But I would think it's more to do with individual species and their evolution in terms of mating than it is to do with the climate that they're in. Although you do find a lot more brightly coloured birds where it's warm. Maybe just because it's warm and everyone's slightly brighter and happier when you're warm, in my general experience, or I can only speak for myself, is bitterly morbid when it is very cold. Come on, Mr. Q. I know you're in here somewhere. So he's in not the biggest block. We think he's between this little two-track here called Pipeline and Owl's Nest and the Pan. Now, it isn't the biggest block, but it's also a very thick block, which makes it quite a challenging one. I'm really hoping he decides to meander down towards the waterhole for a drink. But if he doesn't, it seems to be the elephants here come and drink at the Pan a little bit later in the evening. So Aaron in New Zealand's wondering if I've ever seen a male leopard bigger than the Anderson male, and I haven't. I went and looked back at some of my photographs of the biggest male I'd seen prior to Anderson, called the Camp Pan male, and looking at pictures of them at about the same age, Anderson is bigger. I hate to admit it, because Campy was one of my favorites. Was one of my favorites. He's unfortunately passed on. Interesting enough, the Camp Pan male is the oldest documented male leopard recorded, excuse me, in the wild. Let's hope it's not one of those bouts of 25 sneezes for the next while. Well, I'll take the sneezes if they bring quarantine out to come have a look what's making a noise. Achoo! Brr. Lots of dust in the air at the moment. Come on, Mr. Q, come have a look at what's sneezing. Checking very carefully, yeah? Sorry, I'm not speaking. I'm about to sneeze again. My record was about 26, but hopefully it doesn't go on that long. So we're coming out to the Cheetah Plains Pan again. And I'm hoping this is the only water around here, so he might come for a drink. But alas, no leopard just yet. Achoo! Just, my nose, a single wildebeest bull. And it's Gnorman's nemesis. But, I'm going to sneeze again. So before I do, let's go across to Jamie very quickly.
One lone wildebeest starts to settle down for the evening. We've got our dwarf mongoose all ready for bed, just watching us, or they were watching us curiously. Now the funniest part of this sighting for me was the fact that this little guy actually got stuck as he was trying to climb into that hole. And trying to go down head first and turn around at the same time, and it didn't work out all that well for that particular mongoose. Oh. Look how much younger the one on the right is than the one on the left. That's a sub-adult dwarf mongoose. Yes, that's where you got stuck. Don't make the same mistake again. Oh! Another head popping out. I love watching them at this time of day. Yet to see them bonding with each other. And at the same time, they're not quite as lazy as they are first thing in the morning when they're busy sunbathing, waiting for the sun's warmth to heat them up a little bit after a chilly night. And they're also incredibly vocal. And that brief glimpse of that mongoose on the road actually really gives you a sense of scale of just how tiny these little creatures are. Somebody taking a chance at last minute foraging before it gets too dark and it's time to retreat to bed. The noises I'm making are just meant to ever so slightly imitate dwarf mongoose contact calls. Gets them to focus on us ever so slightly every now and again. Now this little mongoose is covered in cobwebs and as a result has picked up all kinds of grass seeds. And that's very common to see them with spider webs all over their faces because of course the spiders make a home or make their webs inside these termite mound vents. And the dwarf mongoose go crashing through them. Also gives you a really nice opportunity to look at just how long the claws of a dwarf mongoose actually are. Oh, budge up, try to get out there. Of course, all of those tunnels interconnected. They can run between entrances. One will disappear down one hole and reappear up out of another. And I think they're actually currently deciding if this is where they're going to spend the night or if they're going to pick another spot further on. Looks as though this particular termite mound vent is winning. Bright beady eyes, pink noses. We retreated to that sighting of the African wildcat a couple of mornings ago. It was exceptionally exciting. And Kat, in Tampa, you were wondering if an African wildcat would hunt baby dwarf mongoose, would hunt adult dwarf mongoose as well, Kat. So it would hunt both of them. Now, an African wildcat is generally never going to dig a dwarf mongoose out from inside its burrow. And what they'll do is they'll wait and they can ambush them, just like it ambushed that scrub hare while we were watching it with great patience, indeed demonstrating far more patience than Viam and myself did, because we honestly thought that it had forgotten all about the fact that it was hunting. So a dwarf mongoose, definitely on the menu of a wildcat. They will, however, most likely eat around the anal gland, because dwarf mongoose do have a very, very strong smelling anal gland. Another animal that hunts dwarf mongoose in particular as a hunting practice is young leopards. And that's something when we saw Shadow's son with his very first live kill, the very first thing that we'd seen that he'd clearly killed himself, was a dwarf mongoose that he wasn't all that interested in eating, but he was clearly interested in playing with and moving around and trying battering about, just practicing that coordination that he would need as an adult leopard. Now baby leopards, leopard cubs, very often hunt dwarf mongoose and squirrels alike. Small, manageable little prey species. All of our dwarf mongoose have now disappeared off. They've decided that this termite-bound burrow is not the place to be. Joyce, who is watching in New Hampshire, you were wondering whether or not mongoose are part of the rodent family. And Joyce, no they're not, although if you go far enough back, there's a very similar ancestral link between the two. Mongoose are actually part of what's known as the Herpestidae family and are more closely related. You're in New Hampshire, Joyce, so I'm sure you've heard of, obviously maybe even seen, things like pine martens, ferrets, ermines, anything like that. Those are all related more closely to a mongoose than mongoose are to rodents. So the Herpestidae family And there's also an animal out here that kind of looks like a mixture between a mongoose and a cat, and that is a genet. Now that's actually something I forgot to mention, but the fact that Dave and myself had a really lovely large spotted genet sighting on our way home last night. It was very late, it was way past the end of drive, so we couldn't go live with it. But we did have a very nice sighting, and that's linked, at one point the mongoose were actually thought to be part of the genet family, part of what's known as the Viviridae. I was gonna stop, sorry, I got distracted by a fork-tailed drongo that was actually happily trilling away, imitating the sound of one of the other birds out here. But it flew away as soon as I stopped to have a look at it. So the vivarians, in other words, the genets and the mustelids, so things like honey badgers, and then the Herpestidae family, the mongoose family, are all closely related but different families completely, so very distinct families. Now they are all, what was that? Sorry, hold on everyone, I don't know what that was, but it's, I think it might have been a hyena. Something dashed across the road very far in front of me. And of course this is the region where we're looking for Karula, but it wasn't feline. Could have been a dacre, but I doubt it. You saw that as well, Jean-André? Yeah. Somewhere here. Oh, what was that? We spend so much time watching things like antelope run and getting so used to the standard visual shape of what we see on a day-to-day basis, that something like that immediately attracts one's attention, because it was not antelope shaped and it was not felid shaped, and it dashed across the road so quickly. I'm just going to concentrate on seeing if I can't spot it. It was too big for a jackal, in my opinion, but it was clearly something very shy. The reason I raced like I did, there's always that small off chance we might bump into a brown hyena. It's happened once before. Might be pushing it to try and wish for it to happen now, but you never know, stranger things have occurred. We saw an African wildcat recently. But I can't find it. And it was so clearly running away. I think that whatever it is feeling particularly, or is particularly skittish or camera shy. Don't know, I have no idea where it went. Crossed somewhere close to where I am now. And I am checking for tracks at the same time, but I don't know, it's difficult to gauge distance. I don't know exactly where it ran across the road. This could end up being forever a mystery. Definitely not Karula. I'm not even sure what I was talking about before I spotted that run across the road. But I'm not completely mad, because Jean-André saw it as well. There definitely was something here. We've gone a bit far. What we'll do is we'll cut through onto the road that runs into this drainage line and across it. Maybe there's a chance we might spot whatever it was over there. Oh yes, we were talking about, I remember now, we were talking about the the three families that are very closely related to each other, the Hippestidae, the Viverrids, and the Mustelidae, the Mustelids. And what I was going to say is that they're all unified by the very common structure, or the structure of the anal gland that is common to all three of those different families. Also very similar to that of the hyena, but ever so slightly different. And the mongoose and the genets, all of them use it as part of their scent marking that they perform. So that is one of the big unifying factors between them. I wonder what that was. I also want to make sure that I don't... Oopsie, we appear to have lost our antenna there. You good? Are you okay there, Jandre? Our antenna just fell backwards, managed to unhook itself. It's back up. Of course, we have to, every now and again, we have to have that level of flexibility, because we have to be able to bend the antenna backwards. One last patch. If we have missed Karula's tracks, or if Karula's tracks have been driven over on Philemon's cut line, this is the one road where she might have popped out. We're checking exceptionally carefully to make sure that we don't miss her tracks as evening starts to fall and as she starts to move about. Look really carefully, first of all, for Karula, and second of all, for our mystery animal that went sprinting across the road. Let's find out what Brent is up to now.
So, we know Quarantine's around, but he's in that really thick block. So what we've done, we've decided to take a nice peruse across the plains again. See if we can spot something. The wildebeest and zebra have moved deeper into Mala. And I just heard a report, very interesting, and unfortunately just to the north of our boundary here at Cheetah Plains, but there's two young male lions, unknown and very skittish from the vehicles. So obviously just moved in from Kruger. Who knows, maybe they'll come south. Temperature's dropping quite quickly. Makes me wonder whether shorts were a good idea today. Well done, Marilyn in Montana, who got the bird quiz. I think this is one of the tougher ones I've given you. But indeed, Marilyn, the African pipit it was. Remember I said, look at the color of the legs and very, very bold facial markings. We couldn't really see, but that yellow base to the bill is sometimes distinct. Sometimes it's not that obvious, but there we go. An African pipit that should be a new one for a few of our birders out there. So well done, Marilyn in Montana. So apart from buffalo, zebra, wildebeest and a steenbok, Cheese Plans has been a little bit quiet, but it has the potential to change any second. And that's why it's always worth that little trip down the road. Never know what's around the next corner. And in this case, it's a beautiful open clearing with puzzle bush, combretum, and Lowveld albizias. This is the first sunset safari I've been down here, and we haven't had those big Eddy bulls coming out from Kruger. Maybe they'll be here tomorrow. So those young male lions were about there. It is a cheetah stick. Bem and I have seen a few cheetah stumps, cheetah sticks today. Once we stopped, zoomed, binoculars, everything, we're like, oh, stick. It was quite disappointing. And I think I know for sure, final control and Vim's most entertaining part of drive was my sneezes. I could hear them cackling on the radio. Evil, evil woman. So I think we should give Final Control a new nickname. What do you think, Fem?
Hyena Den.
I was going to go with Tlhakabafazi, the red-billed wood hoopoes. So the Zulu name for a bird out here, the red-billed wood hoopoe, is... Oh, hyena. Tlhakabafazi, the cackling woman. So why don't you guys let us know what we should call FC from now on. Vim votes for the Hyena Den, and I go for Tlhakabafazi, the cackling woman. So let me know which you would prefer that we call Final Control, and you can pop us an email on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. What are you shouting at, Mr. Go Away Bird? Where are you, actually? Can't see him. He's in this very large false marula somewhere. Can you see them, Vim? They're somewhere in that big tree. Ah. You got him. I've got them. So come out to the left a little bit. I'm sorry, to the right, at the left. Keep coming, there, zoom in there. Center front, there we go, there it is. The gray go away bird, oh, off it flaps. Or we could call Final Control the gray go away birds. Or the arrow marked babblers. Oh, them and I are on a roll. Franklin alarm calling behind us. And we know there's lion and leopard in the area. It could just be a slender mongoose, but let's have a look anyway. We probably follow on average about 50 Franklin alarm calls to one cat sighting, but it's always worth checking. It disappeared through there somewhere. That's where the alarm calls were. Just having a quick careful look. Now all is silent. Nope. Nothing out there, unfortunately, but as I said, it's always worth just checking. And as I say, 50 to 100 Franklin alarm calls, we go check, there's nothing there. It could be a mongoose, it could have been a predatory bird just skimming through, but one in 100 turns into a leopard. Raymond, who's in the Netherlands, who's looking at his own map, is wondering where I'm driving. Raymond, I am on Kestrel Road in the far eastern or northeastern corner of Cheetah Plains. I'm about to come up to the junction of Kestrel and Ingwe Road. We're going to do one last gander past that Cheetah Plains pan area and up around pipeline towards Three in a Row to see if quarantine comes out of that thicket. So we got a comment from Joanne. I don't think VM and I are going to agree with this, Joanne, but I will put it through anyway. And I think a final control is filtering what's coming through to me on this particular subject. Joanne says, well, she agrees with Hyena Den because they control everything anyway. Well, you see, they might be the hyenas, but us, the cameramen, the presenters, we're the lions, so we can beat up hyenas when we want to. We're definitely, and you know what, we let them be, rather than asserting our dominance. We just let them scuttle about. So I don't ever do this, but I'm going to tell you what I just heard in my ear. Ha, ha, ha. But now, across to Jamie with the buffalo.
Oh, well, Brent's been busy mocking the poor ladies of Final Control. Gendre and myself have been very busy scouring the area. And we've come upon a large breeding herd of buffalo rustling their way through into the evening. We've got one young male watching us with great intent, such intent that he's forgotten about the mouthful of grass that he has. Still looks a little bit confused as to what he should do with it. Yes, there we go, almost, there we go. Nope. still watching us too closely. Sort of looks like it's almost idle, the way that we sometimes pluck a blade of grass and chew on it. Come on, boy. You can't stop watching him now. We're going to wait for him to eat that mouthful of grass. Yes, no? Oh, yeah, you see, you gotta take a lesson from the ladies. She knows what to do with a mouthful of grass. Hello, boy. You can finish your mouthful, I promise. He's got a slight glaucoma almost to his eye. His right eye is a little bit swollen and bulging. Doesn't look terribly comfortable. It does occasionally happen with buffalo. It's one of the reasons why you sometimes see them with those big cataracts. Oh, it's a scary time for buffalo as darkness starts to descend, and this herd will be looking to find a nice open spot, quite possibly quarantine clearings again, to spend the night in. They don't really want to be hiding here when it does get completely dark. Many months ago, Brent and myself were both in this area when the Nkuhumas were hunting a herd of buffalo right close to where we are now. It turned out to be an exceptionally intense sighting, with the buffalo fighting back and chasing the lions. Though you never know, there could well be lions moving behind them. This morning on the sunrise safari, Brent had the Tsalala pride, or as I was caught out saying this morning, the Tsalala pride, just because that's the nickname that we've started to give them. Didn't quite realize that you were all on the back of the vehicle with me. I was caught unawares. But they were very, very close to the boundary of Arethusa and Shirley's. We suspect that they would have crossed. That's why we haven't followed up with them this afternoon. But with a herd of buffalo like this walking through an area, we don't want to get any closer and scare them. It's not a huge herd. From what I can hear and from what I can see. But it's very easy for lions to track a herd of buffalo like this. Noisy and smelly. A scent kind of like a dairy farm when you hang around a buffalo herd. There's something exceptionally picturesque about them in the dusty winter's evening light. And if I'm quiet for a moment, you can just hear the rustling all around us. Almost like an elephant herd moving through an area. What on earth is this bull doing? There's a bull here that is really thoroughly thrashing the tree in front of him. Not sure what it's done to offend him. Might just be a good scratching post. Oh no, he's finished off and he's going to catch up with the rest of the herd and is one big buffalo bull. Sure. He's not just in terms of horn size, just in terms of sheer bulk. That animal must be close to 2,000 pounds, just under 2,000 pounds in weight. On top of his head, of course, that fearsome head of horns. Addison, you were wondering. We spoke earlier on the school drive about the fact that the buff or any kind of antelope or and now? Sorry, Addison, haven't forgotten about you. He's having a bit of a showdown between two buffalo bulls, which could in turn lead to a sparring session and in turn lead to broken horns. Now, Addison, we were talking on the school drive earlier about the fact that an antelope horns are solid bones. The same applies to that of or the head of horns of a buffalo. So if a buffalo horn does break off, no, it will never ever grow back. Sometimes they get damaged and they grow in a strange way, But if it is snapped off completely, it will bleed because it is living bone. And it will probably, actually, if it's quite close to the boss, it will be quite uncomfortable for them. But it will never, ever be capable of growing back. Enjoy a little bit more of the sighting before it does get too dark. It is getting quite dark and we won't shine lights on them. They are diurnal animals, daytime animals, so we don't want to interfere in any way with their nocturnal vision. Especially not with the possibility of lions moving about. The Birmingham boys have been scattered everywhere. We haven't managed to track down all of them. We don't want to run the risk of interfering with them any more than necessary. Breeding herds like this provide a nice opportunity to just compare the horns of the females versus the males. So there we go, big female. You can see that there is, in this afternoon light, you can actually see the tufts of hair on the top of her horns, which are much thinner, particularly at the base, than that of a male. We've got one slightly damaged horn, so there you go, what we were talking about, Addison. Her left horn hasn't grown normally. She's also got some kind of mange or fungal infection on her skin that's caused that bald patchiness. Oh, buffalo, you're going into a very thick area in which to spend your night. This little calf on the right, that's probably one of the scariest ages for a buffalo to be. Buffalo is the perfect size for a pride of lions like the Nkuhungas to tackle. The Birmingham boys, of course, as proficient buffalo hunters, will tackle something larger. They'll go for the adults. But that's because they've got at least a good 200 pounds weight. Each male lion is heavier by 200 pounds than the female, so they're capable of taking down buffalo. Now, out here in the Kruger National Park, a large percentage of these buffalo, particularly in the southern and the central part of the Kruger National Park, will have tuberculosis as a naturally occurring disease. It only really affects them when something else has weakened them, whether it's through injury or poor diet or age, that they start to really exhibit signs of tuberculosis interfering with them. However, in South Africa, it's become a very interesting story, the playing out of the buffalo tuberculosis within the naturally occurring populations, because it jumps very quickly to cattle. Now, there's a big aspect or big part of South Africa's farming industry is cattle farming, and as a result it had to be exceptionally carefully managed. And that, what that means is that to the west of us, as we look across to the setting sun, there is something called the red line, and any animal west of that red line, any buffalo, is actually disease-free, does not have tuberculosis. And a huge amount of time and effort was put into separating the diseased versus the disease-free population and keeping them separate from each other. Very difficult, you actually cannot transport buffalo across that red line. What that's meant is that for the disease-free population to the west, some of them have become worth a huge amount of money. And by a huge amount of money, I'm talking 44 million rand was paid for one buffalo bull at auction at one point in South Africa. Can't remember his name, I think his name was Million. And it was one of the most expensive buffalo ever sold. And that was about 2 or 3 years ago. On that exchange, on our exchange rate at the moment, you can work that out to about $3 million would be around roughly what we're looking at. Oh my word, our exchange rate's got quite bad. The South African rand not doing very well. So if you find yourself in the position to come to visit South Africa, and you are in a different country, now's the time. Everything's going to be much cheaper for you. $3 million for one buffalo. And your average cow disease-free cow could go for close to R500,000. So again, about, what's that, $30,000? $25,000 to $30,000. They are incredibly valuable animals. It is a bit too dark for us to spend any more time with this buffalo herd. I think we're going to move on. Good luck, buffalo. Hope you see yourselves safely through the night. And on we go. Winter time, which means we've got all kinds of exciting, rare and nocturnal creatures to go looking for. Yesterday we saw, David and myself saw a white-tailed mongoose and a genet on our way home. We're going to start looking for, those are not rare animals at all. Those are safari guests. Having a quick stop to stretch their legs and have a sundowner. Beautiful spot they've chosen. Feeling a bit bad about interrupting them, so all of our lights are going to go down. We want to blind the guests. I just need to chat to the guide quickly as we go through. I didn't mean to come and interrupt their drink stop. I'm just going to apologize quickly. Can't drive past without saying hello. That's okay, it's Taxon. How's it, guys?
What you got?
No, nothing this afternoon, just buffalo up that side. Sorry, Tax.
Get the secret away.
Sorry to interrupt your drink stop. Beautiful evening. All right, well, welcome to Juma. Hope you enjoy your stay. Cheers. I'm just going to keep my lights off for now. We don't disrupt their view. Janet, you were wondering on our live drives if we ever encounter any venomous snakes. And we do. On a relatively regular basis in summer, we actually had two extraordinary black, or myself, I had two extraordinary black mamba sightings. Both individuals well over 6 feet in length, over 2 meters, and incredibly relaxed. We've seen spitting cobra before. We have seen puff adders before on the live drive. So lots of the venomous snakes have made themselves known to us in the past. And that's something for us to anticipate. The thing is, because in the low veld, our winters are relatively mild, although you wouldn't believe it the way that we complain on a chilly morning, but our winters are in fact relatively mild. And what that means is the snakes of this area generally go into what's known as estivation, which isn't quite as dramatic as a hibernation. And it's more to do with the dryness of the area than it is to do with the cold. What that means is that even in midwinter, we could still enjoy a snake sighting. They will often come out of their hiding holes and come and bask in the sun on the roads or anywhere else in those sorts of areas, just to enjoy a little bit of warmth and possibly even go looking for a snack. And it's the one time where you do actually start to see snakes even more frequently close to the camps and to the houses, more in the houses than anything else. Snakes looking for warmth and also looking for rodents, which are in turn looking for warmth and additional food. Venomous snakes are one of my favorite creatures to see out here. That black mamba sighting that we had was absolutely incredible. And as long as they are treated with complete respect, the chances are relatively slim that you run the risk of antagonizing them and being bitten. And about 90% of snake bites in South Africa have not come from snakes attacking humans, but from people either trying to catch them or to handle them in some way, and in turn being bitten in that process. So if you ever do come to South Africa as a guest, there is no reason to be nervous of snakes. Be aware and treat them with utmost respect. Always carry a torch at night and you will be absolutely fine. There's another venomous creature out here, and that is the scorpion, something that inspires fear in a great deal of people. And we do have a question about what different types of scorpions we get out here. And Mandy, you were wondering about which scorpions we get. We get a couple of different types. We get the Scorpionidae family, and there's lots of different species from the Opisthocampus glabrifrons, which was one of Scott's favorite scorpion types, which is very similar to a sort of bark type scorpion. Large, they look terrifying. They're huge, they can be larger than my hand, but they've got relatively small tails in proportion to their pincers. They're also exceptionally docile scorpions, which means that you can safely, if you know what you're doing, you can actually safely handle them. They're also very kind in that they hiss, they stridulate to warn you before they even think about stinging. So if you get stung by one of those, it will hurt. It's not comfortable, but there's no risk that you're going to, under normal circumstances, there's no risk to an adult human's life. And then you get the more dangerous species, the Parabuthidae, or the Buthidae species. And there's a couple of different ones that fall into that family. Those are the thick-tailed scorpions. Thick tail, small. The thicker the tail and the smaller the pincer, the more dangerous that scorpion happens to be. The more venomous it is. And those are the ones that you should watch out for. But again, scorpion stings are exceptionally rare out here. And we spoke about it earlier for Cameron, who asked about the scorpions that we get. Most of them are going to be pretty much invisible until we get around August, September time, at the end of winter and the beginning of spring. Zoe, welcome to the Sunset Safari. You're saying that you don't feel very clued up on the civets and the genets, and you were wondering if they are related in some way. And yes, they're all part, we discussed earlier the mustelids and the viverrids. They are all part of the Viverridae family, again, unified by the anal gland, so an evolutionary history in that sense. And in quite a bit of their skull structure as well. There's a lot of similarities in their skull structure and their dentition. The difference between civets and genets, however, civets are much larger than genets. They're quite big animals, the size of a sort of European badger. Quite big, quite stocky animals. Similar colouring, but a very different diet to that of a genet. A genet is quite a fierce little predator and very nimble. Very good at climbing trees and as a result will focus on, similar to a wildcat, hunting little rodents, insects and various other smaller species, even raiding birds' nests, which is why birds do alarm call regularly at them. Now a civet will also have a diet that can be based on on insects, and in fact are the only animals capable of eating something called a millipede. Now, their diet differs ever so slightly. They're not quite as fast or as nimble as a genet, and they also have a very high percentage of berries and fruit in their diet as well, to the point that they could be considered to be, at this time of year, with a lack of millipedes, they're definitely omnivorous. Whereas a genet is largely carnivorous, with the odd supplement to their diet in the form of fruit, if they happen to find any. And there's two different species of genet out here. There's the large spotted and the small spotted. and they are pretty much indistinguishable from each other, except from the fact that, as the large spotted name suggests, they have slightly larger spots on their coats, as well as the fact that their tail patterning, their tail striping, is ever so slightly different, with one species having white on the tip and one species having black. Oh, lots of impala about. I'm just going to dim my lights for this individual. Oh boy, are you going to go across in front of me? Yes, no? No? Okay. All right, thank you. Yes, there we go. As soon as I switched my lights off, he felt more confident to dash across. Here's a lovely question on the subject of baboons that we were talking about earlier. James was wondering about the evolutionary reason behind why baboons have an upright and yet slightly downward curved tail. Now, I could only really guess at what the reason is for that. Maybe it helps with the following for baboon troops to help follow each other. But what I can tell you is that's one of the ways to age a baboon. The older a baboon gets, the more erect the tail becomes and the more pronounced that curve in the tail becomes. Now that's actually one of the ways that you can start to tell the age of a baboon. In addition to that, males darken in color as they grow older and females get lighter in color as they grow older. Now I'm trying to think if there's any other evolutionary design, because baboons don't really use their tails in the same way that vervet monkeys do. They don't have the same level of dexterity, really, that the vervets do. But they can still use them to assist and to help them balance when they are climbing trees. But I'm trying to think why they would need that upward curve. Excuse me. Perhaps maybe, James, just a remnant of a time when that tail was a bit more dexterous and a bit more useful in a baboon's ancestral life. But I'm not 100% sure. Okay, well, we go looking for all kinds of mysteries of the evening. Rent has left Cheetah Plains, found some signal, and is on his way home. Let's find out how his evening's going.
Hello, hello!
Yes, we are back from the plains of the cheetah. Unfortunately, young quarantine evaded us, but definitely might be worthwhile following up in the morning. So we're heading down the southern boundary, about to duck into Juma shortly, and see what we can find in the night. I want to check that open area around Twin Dams, the possibility of any little nocturnal carnivores, and maybe even around Chelepan, there could be something happening there. But we have some traffic on the road. So, while we wait for this vehicle to pass us, hello, hello. John is wondering, what is the difference between Juma and Cheetah Plains' fauna and flora? Wow, John. Mostly, from a tree point of view, there are a lot of the similar species. There's more of certain species than I have. Both of them have a lot of red bush willow, but on the slightly sandier soils of Cheetah Plains, you have long-tailed cassia, a very nice tree, but in general a lot of the same species but in different spheres. So you will find the bush willows on Juma are generally a lot bigger, and it's gonna get cold here. And there's a certain spot on Cheetah Plains where there's a red soil where the knob thorns and leadwoods are really lovely and large, and you do have a few spots like that on Juma. But also Juma's got this, what we've just crossed through here, the Mawati River. So you do have that riverine vegetation, big leadwoods, big jackalberries, big scotias all along the river, which you don't have at Cheetah Plains. But of course on Cheetah Plains you have those open sodic soils. So you have those wonderful short grasses that attract wildebeest, ostrich, cheetah, and even buffalo and elephant. Let's have a quick look on another sodic site, but not as big. And hopefully we will find a little nocturnal predator there. And fingers crossed. And as it gets deeper and deeper into winter, those little nocturnal predators are going to start coming out earlier and earlier because it's cooler. I'm still hoping we see a porcupine one of these days. That would be fantastic. This is this little sodic short grass area I wanted to check. Alas, zilch. But Vim and I are being very brave driving down next to the Mawati River where it's, just a scrub here on the short grass plains. Have a quick look at him. I'm not gonna leave the light on him for too long. There he is. Getting moving, getting grazing. There's some impala also sleeping out in the open here, but we're not gonna put the lights on them. Now, if we do have any new viewers there, we do not shine our lights on diurnal species, impala, zebra, giraffe. The light blinds them for a short while if we leave the light on them. And that can make them vulnerable to a predator. And of course, we're here to observe, not to interfere. So we don't want to give the predators or the prey an advantage. We want nature to take place as it should and let it unfold before our eyes. Maybe we can find a little bush baby. That would be wonderful. We've been having some really nice bush baby sightings. Had a lovely one yesterday evening, even though it was very brief. Nice clear view. Of course, we might see some owls. Whoa, hello. Sorry about that. Mr. Waterbuck, we'll just leave the light down. You can see this big male waterbuck literally popped out of a gwari bush right next to me. Would have been better if it was a leopard though, not a water buck. So hi Jim in Oklahoma, who's been watching for over a year and has never seen an African wildcat. So Jim, I've been guiding here for over a year and I haven't seen an African wildcat. I think the only one of the Safari Live presenters who has been spoilt with a wonderful African wildcat sighting was Jamie, and the cameraman that was spoilt with her is Viam, who's sitting behind me. So we've only had one sighting, so we don't see them often at all. But now with this drought and the dry season coming, the chances of seeing a lot of those little creatures we don't see too often definitely becomes greater. So keep watching, Jim, and hopefully we'll find you a wildcat. So Ellen's wondering if there have been any accidents with animals on drive. She said that reminded her of a deer dashing out on the road. Even if an animal like that dashes out close to us, Ellen, we're never really moving quick enough to have an accident. It's very seldom, and especially at night, that we're going much over about 9 or 10 miles an hour. So no, there haven't been any accidents, and hopefully there will never be any accidents. I don't think there will be. We're all quite conscious, quite careful. And I mean, I just picked up the movement out of the periphery, and we managed to see that water bike before he stepped into the road. Oh, I think it's time for a headgear change. So Lynn, who is on or using the Twitter sphere, there we go, that's much better. Now my ears are warm. Is wondering, is there going to be an after drive chat on Facebook? And I think, yes, tonight, Lynn, there shall be an after drive chat on Facebook. So just give us a little time after we get back from drive and we will do a little chat this evening. And for those of you who don't know where to find the chat, it is on Safari Live's Facebook page, and we will be doing a live chat. So not only do you get a live game drive, you get a live chat afterwards this evening. So let's hope we can find something in the last few minutes. Come on, VM, what do you think? What are we gonna find? A nightjar. Jim's playing it safe. I say, African civet. Come on, civet. Or an owl. I would like an owl. Oh no, it's a steenbok. Oh dear. Darn. So we get two species of genets, small spotted and large spotted genets. And James Richard is wondering, do they compete for food and which dominates over the other? Where they overlap, they definitely compete for food, but they also don't all sort of live in the same area. The small spotted genet can live in drier areas. But I would probably say being a slightly, they're not that much different in size. So I'd say the large spotted is slightly, no, I don't think it is slightly larger. So maybe it does dominate, but with a lot of things, a lot of animals try avoid confrontation rather than fighting. So you might find they might try avoid each other. So you might notice these large piles of sand next to the road, and that's to repair the mitre drains, these big bumps that we go over. But from VM and myself, it's been a joy having you on the Sunset Safari with us, and hopefully we'll find some leopards finally on the Sunrise Safari tomorrow. So don't forget to join us, and for the last few minutes or moments of drive, let's go to Jamie so she can bid you adieu.
Oh, we've come to the end of our sunset safari, and we'll have to follow up on Karula tomorrow morning and see where she's disappeared off to. Another beautiful evening awaits us, and a big thank you to Jandre for all of your fantastic camera work, as well as to Jerry and to Lou in final control. Thank you to you all, and have a wonderful day wherever you are in the world. We'll catch you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
they're so chilled.